Admitting the delicacy of renaming a 1300-year-old god, Kamal gave the Muezzins a time allowance to learn the Quran in Turkish. Kamal yielded. Let them pray as they please, temporarily, he growled. Beaming, his ministers rushed off to proclaim the glad tidings only a few hours before the new moon appeared. They suavely declared, prayers may be offered and the Quran recited in Arabic during the present month of Ramadan, but discourse by the imams must be in Turkish. During Ramadan, all Muslims are especially irritable because they eat nothing during the hours of daylight. After the fasting is over, Turks will be more tractable and may hence accept from their dictator a new name for their god. A year later in pious Bruza, the Green City, a muezzin shouted, Tanri Uludur, from one of the minarets whence Bruzans had heard Allahu Akbar since the 14th century. Raging at Kamal Pasha's god, they mobbed the muezzin and mobbed the police who came to save him. Quick to defend his new word for God, quicker to show new Turkey the fate of the old-fashioned, Kamal the Ghazi, the victorious one, pounced on Bruza, had 60 of the faithful arrested, ousted the Mufti, the ecclesiastical judge of the mosque, and decreed that henceforth God was Tanri. Like all dictators, he was energetic, single-minded, easily irritable. Both in private and public, he was sarcastic, brutal, and abrupt. He flared up at the least criticism. He cut short all attempts to reason with him. He flew into a passion at the least opposition. He would neither confide in nor cooperate with anyone. When a venerable member of the cabinet suggested that it was unseemly for Turkish ladies to dance in public, he threw a Quran at him and chased him out of his office with a stick. Kemal Atatürk made the following unforgettable and, from the point of view of fundamentalist believers, unforgivable remarks. For 500 years, these rules and theories of an Arab sheikh, Muhammad, he said, and the interpretations of generations of lazy, good-for-nothing mullahs have decided the civil and the criminal law of Turkey. They had decided the form of the constitution, the details of the lives of each Turk, his food, his hours of rising and sleeping, the shape of his clothes, the routine of the midwife who produced his children, what he learned in his schools, his customs, his thoughts, even his most intimate habits. Islam, this theology of an immoral Arab, is a dead thing. Possibly it might have suited tribes of nomads in the desert. It is no good for a modern progressive state. And the mullahs, how he hated them. As far as he was concerned, they were lazy and unproductive good-for-nothing men who ate up the sustenance of the people. He would chase them out of their mosques and madrasas to work like men. Religion, he would tear religion from Turkey as one might tear the throttling ivy away to save a young tree. Kamal cared nothing about Allah. He was interested only in Turkey. He despised Allah and made him responsible for Turkey's misfortune. It was Allah's tyrannical rule that paralyzed the minds of the Turks. But he also knew that Allah was real to the uneducated and generally ignorant Turkish peasants, while nationalism meant nothing to them. He decided, therefore, to draft Allah into his service as the publicity director of his national cause. Through Allah's aid, his people must cease to be Mohammedans and become Turks. Then, after Allah had served Kamal's purpose, he could discard him. The irony of ironies of this methodology, just in case it escapes the attention of you, my listeners, is that Kamal was using Allah in exactly the same way that Muhammad did for his own selfish purposes 1400 years earlier. For Kamal, Islam and civilization were a contradiction in terms, an oxymoron. He once said of the Turks, with a flash of cynical insight and a morbid sense of humor, if only we could make them Christians. His Turkey was not to be the reformed Islamic state for which the faithful were waiting. It was to be a strictly lay state, with a centralized government as strong as the sultans, backed by the army and run by his own intellectual bureaucracy. Inspecting some soldiers in Anatolia, Kamal once asked, "Who is God and where does he live?" The soldier, anxious to please, replied, "God is Mustafa Kemal Pasha. He lives in Ankara." "And where is Ankara?" Kamal asked. "Ankara is in Istanbul," was the reply. Further down the line, he asked another soldier, "Who is Mustafa Kemal?" The reply was, "Our Sultan, Ifran Orga, Phoenix Ascendant." Ladies and gentlemen, so-called believers and unbelievers, the tragedy of ignorance in Muhammadan Islam is the fact that whenever matters get bad in their society, they truly and unbendingly believe it is because Allah is punishing them for not being faithful to His words in the Quran. Hence, they try to become more faithful to the words of the Quran, thus sinking into a truly vicious downward spiral that feeds on greater ignorance, more hatred of unbelievers, more paranoia, and more anger. As we speak today, this introspection is exactly what is happening in Turkey today with the Islamists trying their best to take political control, to start with and turn Turkey into another Muhammadan Muslim theocracy like Iran. They do not and cannot understand or accept facts and or reality. Their mindset, like the mindset of all fundamentalists, is closed upon itself and incapable of rationality, evaluation, comparing, contrasting, and reasoning. Such a closed mind will not comprehend that economics and social conditions in society are not determined by the Almighty, but are man-made and can only be rectified by man. As we have asserted in numerous chapters, all fundamentalist beliefs are unconditional surrender of logic, reality, and facts. A fundamentalist belief is not subject to rational or scientific explanation. It is an all-or-nothing mindset. Mr. Newt Gingrich, the previous Speaker of the House in the United States, perfectly explained the mindset of fundamentalist Muhammadan Muslims, and I quote, "Religiously driven people do things that don't calculate in nice academic faculty surroundings. And they don't calculate with the State Department. And they don't calculate in any perceived rational way. We watch in horror and disgust almost every day on our television screens how these so-called peace-loving believers invariably target for slaughter and brutality unarmed civilians, be they followers of Muhammad or not. From the Philippines to Bali, Indonesia. From Afghanistan to Uzbekistan. From Iran and Iraq to Israel. From Yemen and Saudi Arabia to Jordan. From North Africa to South Africa. From Europe to Americas." Kemal Ataturk was perfectly correct. It is the Quran, the whole Quran, and nothing but the Quran that drives these creatures to do Satan's bidding.